Hello, viewers. Today you join me nearing the end, I hope, of a fairly lengthy and moderately frustrating tinkering and experimenting session. I am revisiting my railroad turnout or switch machine controller, which some of you may remember involves these infrared sensors buried in the track to control a servo motor underneath the track, which changes the position of the switch. And there's also a set of buttons that overrides it so you can manually control it. Over there you can see the underside of the two infrared sensors, and there is the servo motor, and there professionally mounted is the Arduino Nano that's controlling the whole shooting match. But the point of this is so that when I'm running the railroad by myself, I don't accidentally send a train up against a switch that is set in the wrong direction. That's set in the right direction, but if it was set in the wrong direction, there would be a derailment when that happens. Not ideal. And then my decision to revisit this was based on my wanting to get around to upgrading it so that it would control multiple turnout machines, switch machines, and so I could install multiple servo motors all around the railroad. Yeah, I know I'd planned to do that years ago and I just never got around to it. So I was hoping to get to doing that now. And a few different things occurred to me. I could either use an Arduino Nano. This is just a different form factor, but it is a Nano with the screw terminals built into it. I could use that to control multiple switch machines, or I could take something like this DigiSpark, which is an ATtiny 85, or an actual ATtiny 85, like I've got over here, and just use those one per switch machine, which I'd thought would work out, but that's the basis of my frustration over the last several evenings. The first thing I thought about was, are there enough pins on it and whatnot to do what I needed to do? And there is. The source of my hunting and searching in vain was the fact that the ATtiny 85 doesn't work with the standard servo library that comes with the Arduino IDE. So I went hunting around and I found three or four other libraries that claim to work with it, that use the timers in different ways, use the timers that it does have. But unfortunately, I've discovered, and it may be just the limitations of my coding skills, but as soon as I start putting a bunch of different stuff into the loop, the servo motor gets really jittery and unpredictable and unstable. And like I said, I've spent several evenings on this and I decided to just give up. Plan B. Move back to an Arduino Nano. And I wanted to add some other features because I noticed that I had the physical positions of the servo motor hard-coded into the code, which once you get it set up is fine, but it's kind of experimental. You have to just keep reprogramming and reprogramming and reprogramming it until you find the magic numbers that park it in the right spot. So I decided to move on and I've added a couple of potentiometers to the circuit. So now we have two push buttons, which pull low. So there's a pull up built into the Arduino that we're using. So that's the two controls. And then each one of them has a potentiometer associated with it going to an analog input. And those will set the limits for each direction. Let me show you. I'm not sure how deep I'm going to go into this code. Probably not too deep. I'll upload it even though it's embarrassingly crap. As I mentioned, I was messing around with a bunch of different libraries and the one that started working for me happens to be this Adafruit soft servo. The normal servo library would work too, but this just happens to be the one that I landed on. Bunch of defines. The two buttons are input pull-ups. Attach the servo to the servo pin as defined earlier. So what this does in the beginning here, it just sets the turnout to the normal route as opposed to the diverging route, just as a place to start so that it's in a known state. And then the loop, the pots and the buttons, and basically just some variables. Read the two pots. If the N button is pushed or the or its corresponding optical sensor, then write the servo position off that one pot mapped to the correct size, because the analog read will give you a 0 to 1023 and the servo uses 0 to 180 degrees as its output, so this just scales it. There are other ways of doing it, other non-Arduino ways, other more standard C ways. This is an Arduino function. I'm going to use it. And then we write that servo position. If the other button's pushed, do the same thing, read its pot and write that to the servo position. And then this library uses a servo refresh, which basically tells it to actually finish the movement sequence. At least that's how I understand it. And then I delay for a wee tiny bit of time, and the loop carries on again. Pretty simplistic. That's the kind of code that I'm capable of doing, so that's what you get if you want. Just feel free to take it, modify it, ridicule it, whatever you want. So here we are powered on right now, and as you can see, the two buttons make the servo motor go to different places. If I hold this button and adjust that, I can set the position where it stops. And the same with the other one. So that way I don't have to constantly be reprogramming the thing when I'm installing it. So I think that is a win. So for each switch or each turnout, I need a total of 5 pins, 3 digital and 2 analog, and the digital become the limiting factor. Because there are 8 analog pins on a nano, so I could run up to 4 of these in analog, but I've only got basically 10, I guess 11 if I count D13, usable digital pins, and that means I can only run 3 of these circuits. That's a reasonable economy, because the these DigiSparks run about 3-something Canadian, and a typical nano is, you know, closer to $4 or $5 Canadian by the time you get it shipped here. So I think it's reasonable enough. Now then, the nano that I'm using already is sitting on one of these shields. And these shields have the, let's turn it the right way up, have the ground voltage and signal broken out for each of the pins. And it's in the same pinout as the servos already need. So you just plug those directly on there, and then I've already got the signal and power for the optical sensors and the push buttons coming back to these and wired to these. So that makes it fairly modular and easy to plug in and out and maintain and whatnot. So I think I am going to build my little potentiometer rig off this one, so that I can just plonk it onto the one that's actually over on the railroad. Since I'm using these potentiometers as, well, as a voltage divider, effectively, the middle pin is the wiper, the two outer pins are the fixed parts of the resistor. So I'd want power and ground on the two outer ones and signal on the middle one. Unfortunately, that's not how they're lined up on here. So I'm thinking of taking these two rows of header pin, female headers there, and soldering 2 legs of the potentiometer on there, and then from the ground running around with a little piece of wire as a bus bar and picking up all the ground sides of the potentiometers. Could be a little bit janky, but I think it'll work. There, that's the third attempt, and I think it's going to do the job. I hope so anyways, because I don't really want to rebuild it again. In the next step, I'm going to solder some of these potentiometers on there. Now, these, all I've got right now is 10K. So if I put six of them in parallel across the power bus. That's going to be the equivalent of 10, 15, one and a bit, between 1 and 2K across the power bus, which will draw it down a little bit. So I don't want that. I've got some 100Ks on order. But for now, I think I'll just put two of them in there and call it a day for this part of the experiment anyway. And I'm sure this is going to be harder than I anticipated as well. Okay, I think that's got it. And they even sit fairly close together. Nice. So now I just have to transfer this to the other one and reload my new software. Yeah, that was a lot harder than it should have been. I may have to rethink this design a little bit. I realized that I kind of thwarted myself over here because I soldered a couple of the wires onto this board, the wires for the push buttons. I should have socketed them somehow, except for they go in parallel with the sensor, so I'm not quite sure how I would have done that. There we go. I think that'll work. Push it down with the soft part of that instead of the soft part of my fingers so they don't perforate my fingers. Yeah, looks like my scabby solder is still holding together. We'll go with that. Let's pop the Arduino out of its socket, take it over to the bench for programming. Okay, so let's see what happens. I just covered one of the sensors, and we'll see which one of these moves it, if anything. Sounds like it's doing something. Hopefully that'll start moving soon. I get enough turns on this. Okay, I finally got it. I just was at the wrong end of these pots. So when I adjust that, you can see it's setting itself into position. There, let's find a place where it's physically tight but not making noise. And then I'll move my cover onto the other one. There you go, and you see they both work now. I'll have to adjust that one just a hair more, I think. There we go. What that noise is it just fighting to try and get to its set point, even though the mechanical system won't allow it, but it's still trying. So there, I've got the point set against the oncoming train. And if the train comes in and across the sensor right there, it switches just as it should. And then I can switch it back with the push button if I want to manually. That's the thing, if I'm coming from this direction here, then I have to manually choose which direction it is using the push buttons. But if I'm coming around the other direction and I'm being inattentive, then I'm not going to cause a derailment. Job done. And as I said, the whole point of this exercise was so that when I'm initially installing it and adjusting it, I can fine-tune it without having to reprogram the thing 1,000 times, which I think is going to be a win. But I do need to, I think, find a little bit more elegant way of mounting those pots, because that's not perfect. I'm starting to lean more towards a custom board, but that's a whole new skill set of CAD that I've never played with before. Wonder if I have time to figure it out. I don't know. Lots of people have figured it out. I'm sure it's possible. I'm just not sure if that's the direction I feel like going. That was a lot more effort than it looked like. Mostly the fiddly bits of the soldering to get the that thing to fit onto there, and the stuff that you didn't see for several days ahead trying to get this to work on an ET Tiny and failing. I don't know, you don't have to be an expert in all these things to enjoy this hobby. You just a matter of tinkering around and experimenting and learning on the fly. That's what I do. Thanks for watching. Comments and questions down below as usual. I'll talk to you later.